we're all, if I just go like, "How you doing, Sam?"
Yeah, okay.
So I'll just say, it's not even an intro, really. If I just say, like, I'm doing
but
fine.
But it only works if you say, I'm doing fine, thanks, James. So otherwise, it doesn't work.
Yeah. Okay, so how you doing, Sam?
I'm doing fine, thanks, James.
And how about you, Johnny? How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thanks, James.
But for some reason, it works every time.
You have to say that, though.
You have to
say
that.
I'm going
to
steal that one off you.
Yeah.
Yeah, if it looks like I'm not looking at you, it's because I've smashed my screen. I've got to look over here.
I got new year, new technology here. Check this out.
Nice. How do you do that?
Yeah, it's fucking new year, isn't it? I got a cable. Best thing about it is I can also record that. So like that's just in the podcast now.
How do you put that into the pod?
Just in. Don't ask, man.
Yeah, I didn't mean
set up here. And like we're all wearing hats too, which is nice, I guess.
Yeah.
That's a nice thing.
Kind of a more of a morning like bedhead kind of situation on my end, but
we're not allowed out of our houses here, so there's no haircuts, so everyone's looking a bit, you know, shabby.
Oh yeah. I know.
Shit. That's crazy. I guess like one in five people in England have had COVID now and they just figured out.
Yeah, and there's one in 30 in London currently have it. So just statistically, that means there's like about 30 people on my street alone, you know, because London's so crowded. So yeah, everyone, you're looking at everyone in the street like, have you got it, you plaguey bastard? But I'm not really going outside, to be honest. So
well, I hope that, you know, I guess that means if it's one in 30, I could name 30 old rock and rollers living in London. You know, maybe Ray or Dave.
One of them's going to get it, aren't they?
Well, I saw there was that the famous Christmas photo of Ray and Dave out having a beer. And then I saw on Dave's Instagram account, which I spent a little time with last night, that he took a little heat for not wearing a mask in some of the photos.
So he'll
be the one to get it for sure.
Yeah,
you saw him up on Hackney Marshes or something.
Hampstead Heath, actually,
where they go dogging. That's where you go dogging if you're a politician.
Yeah, it was about a month ago. No, just before Christmas, like early December. And I've seen Ray all the time because I live in North London and I live right basically about 100 meters away from their studio, Conk. And you see him all the time, just knocking around. But you've never seen Dave before until this one day. And I was sat on the park bench and I could see this old man walking towards me and I was like, I know him. Who is he? And then I looked at him and I just panicked and said, "All right, Dave." And he just went, "Hello, son."
"Hello, my son."
He's got a very fragile voice, hasn't he? He's like up here for some reason.
Is he gay? Yeah.
No, he's not gay. He's got, well, he might be. I don't know. Everyone's a bit fluid these days, aren't they?
Yeah. So true.
Yeah. So
these days, like he's just recently become homosexual.
Yeah, well, he has grown up children. I know he's got a son who's a musician.
But, but that doesn't really explain anything with the rock and rollers of that era. They've all got kids, you know. Yeah. You know, my friend Melanie. You remember Melanie? She lives in London now.
I remember Mel. Yeah, a bit.
She told me that she went to Christmas like in Toronto with some family members she didn't know. One time, and her aunt came. And then her aunt said, "Guys, her aunt was in her 50s. And I have something I have to tell you. I'm bringing my son to Christmas." And she was like, "What?" No one knew she had a son. And then she said, "Yeah, you know, I've kept it secret all these years because I was a bit ashamed because the father was a rock and roller who came through town when I was 16 and I got pregnant." And they all said, "Who was it?" And she said it was one of the members of Fleetwood Mac.
Which one?
We don't know. We just don't know.
That's so
but I,
cool.
That got me thinking, like, can you imagine these guys, many, like, how many kids, like, Jimmy Page had? You know, there's probably hundreds around.
I mean, imagine if they knew they have those genes to play the blues.
Yeah.
You know, imagine finding out.
It could
Jimmy
be like John
Page.
Mayer is Jimmy Page's son.
There's not many of them have successful sons and daughters in the music industry, do they? Like Julian Lennon, Donnie Harrison, You know,
the shadow of your sort of yeah. successful parent just ruins it. Paul McCartney's Dylan's got that kid. Disabled son, hasn't he?
Yeah, he does have a disabled son. Yeah,
yeah.
He just looks like a disabled Paul McCartney.
He does. He's not actually disabled. He's just really odd.
No, yeah. But Paul McCartney's getting more and more disabled the older he gets, too.
He is, yeah.
That's, I'm eating one of these cuties here. You know, I'm really into them. These, like, you know, mandarin oranges.
Very seasonal, festive fruit.
I eat like 10 a day.
It's so good.
It's good for you.
We get them in the morning.
So they say vitamin D is what you need for the COVID protection.
Mm. I take a lot of D, I gotta say. Yeah. I have for a long time, like three a day.
That's what they say about you.
Yeah. A lot of vitamin D.
Crosby's got a son who, like, he found later on, who then was also a music producer, hasn't he? He's like now producing Crosby's records, and he found him like 40 years in.
He also had one with Melissa Etheridge, didn't he, famously? He gave her his sperm.
But the kid OD'd.
That one's died.
Yeah,
he OD'd because he's got Crosby's corrupted drug-addicted genes in him.
Yeah. Well, maybe it's Melissa Etheridge because Crosby's survived. He's like a cockroach. I mean, he's just still going.
Yeah, but it's because he didn't have full Crosby genes, which are like impenetrable to drugs.
That makes so much sense.
But Dave has kids too who are musicians because I was looking in like an uncut magazine kind of 10 albums that I love right now. But, you know, Uncut's it was like great. Hank Williams. It was like old shit. But then he put two of his different sons' albums on the list.
Nice.
Just like as a good dad, you know?
Yeah.
I'd never heard of either of the bands, but.
It's like Johnny Marr as a kid, doesn't he? And it's shit. And Johnny Marr has to like every now and then put it on his Instagram, like, listen to my fucking kid. And it's just like, it's shit. And you know Johnny just can't be arsed putting it up there. But his kid's probably like, please, dad, like, you're famous.
I saw some footage of like a gig he did in Manchester, this son, and he'll do like, 3 sold out nights of the Night and Day, and all it'll be is like 50-year-old Smiths fans hoping that Johnny Marr's going to turn up.
Yeah,
you know, that's it.
Brutal.
Yeah. It's not good having a famous dad, I don't think, apart from the inheritance.
Yeah, Jacob Dylan.
I bet you Bob thought that shit sucked.
Oh my god,
the Wallflowers.
And he was like, "Dad, I got a number one hit."
Yeah,
that's Jacob Dylan for some reason. Dad, I got a number one hit.
It's kind of like a Dylan Ted vibe or something.
Yeah, well, he's kind of got a bit of a
Dylan thing, but he's like a rich entitled brat, so he talks like this too.
Yeah, I can see that.
He's the handsome one of the Dylan kids, isn't he?
He's the handsome one.
I've never seen another one.
Oh mate, there's some really like weird looking ones. There's like some odd like Dylan freaks. Like you want to see the Google the Dylan kids. There's some real strange looking children
creatures.
Yeah, he's the only one that got the sort of, I think, the model looks off.
Is it Sarah the model?
Sarah, yeah.
She's fit, though, isn't she, Sarah?
Probably.
Must have all those songs about her, you know.
Yeah.
I know, exactly. Yeah.
Sarah.
Idiot wind.
Didn't he claim that none of them were actually about her?
No, yeah, even of course, Sarah. Yeah, they're like about like outer space or something.
Yeah, I don't know why people thought they were about for a breakup. They're certainly not.
Yeah, definitely not.
Well, he doesn't own them anymore, so it's not like he can decide. And Neil Young sold his too. Sold his publishing last week.
I'm going to try and sell mine for like 150 quid.
You sold some once for loads of money.
Me?
Yeah.
Nah, I'm not. I sold like some awful music I've made for adverts and stuff.
No, the publishing for Swiss Lip, wasn't that? You got a pretty good deal on that.
Oh, yeah. We did all right, yeah. But, you know, it all went up my nose.
Neil, man, fucking boomers, man. They don't give up, you know.
They don't give up.
It's like my mom, also a boomer. Like you know, recently I was just talking to her, and she was just like, "I can't stand this." I never thought I'd say I'm so sick and tired of seeing Paul McCartney's face. You know, because she used to be in love with him. And then she said, and all this George Clooney, sexiest man alive at age 65, it's a joke. They don't give up.
Idris Elba, though, now.
Well, now, yeah, but, you know, they don't.
Yeah, well, he's, like, also 60.
And somehow, like you said, James, Neil Young's still, like, the most important rocker.
These guys, like, selling their publishing for £150 million for half of it, and it's, like, just there, it's a closed system. So, you know, it is a myth that there's no money in music. We already know that, you know, for like young artists. But like, if Neil Young's taking $150 million of it, like, there is going to be less money to go to new stuff, to more interesting stuff, maybe. I don't know.
Well, also, less money, like, now that, like, a Chevy can do a commercial and put, like, keep on rocking in the free world in it, they're not going to have any need to, like, license some new band's music. You know what I mean? So there's less opportunity, too. It's just, like, it's a complete joke. End of days, man.
Yeah, for some reason with Neil, it really hurts, though.
Because he doesn't need the money, does he? Why are they all doing it?
It's not about money. It's true, that, but it's not even about money. It's more like he has always been, like, against the man. You know what I mean?
But it's just pure hypocrisy with him.
Yeah, it is.
Maybe
yeah.
he's got to make the money back from that shit Pono player thing that he put all of his money into.
No, he Kickstarter that whole thing. He didn't pay any of his own money into that. No, but you know what it is? The reason is it's more indicative of something darker that I think all these people are like, well, like, music had a good run. And, like, probably in 10 years, I'm not going to be making any more money off royalties because no one's going to fucking be listening to it. Spotify doesn't pay shit, so I'll just cash in now. I think that's what's happening.
They'll be dead in 10 years, probably. They're like 70-something now, aren't they? So
yeah.
How do you pronounce the bass player's name in the Kinks?
Oh, Peter Quaif?
Quaif. Quick. Yeah. It sounds like an... Quaif. Like
Quaif.
Quaif.
Yeah.
Quaif, mate. Quaif. Peter Quaif. That's not a real name, Matt.
Is he dead? Is he the one that's dead?
Yeah, he died, yeah.
I read
a thing about... I was reading about, like, the Village Green Preservation Society, like, reissue. Like, you know, like, that they did this, like, deluxe reissue, and there's, like, there's a Pete Townsend, like, kind of, you know, kind of introduction.
Pete Townsend?
Yeah. And Pete Townsend, like, it's dead funny in the introduction. He says, like, he basically just says in the production, in the introduction that, like, Ray is, like, a conservative.
Oh.
And then, well, like, he's kind of like, but it's obviously, like, Pete Townsend is a Tory. Like, he's a posh Tory, Pete Townsend.
So he's
trying to get Ray on, too. And I remember I read a quote from Ray being like, yeah, I wouldn't go as far as saying I'm a conservative, but, you know, I'm kind enough not to have edited Pete's comments out. But, you know, so he's like... Basically using this moment to try and, like, and raise a Tory too.
Yeah, but Pete's a paedophile, so, you know, that's even worse than being a Tory. There's not many things worse than being a Tory.
Yeah. But I guess it does speak to, like, the idea of values in the music. Like, because there's, like, and I think that's what Ray said. He's like, you can still be, like, you know, far left and have values, you know?
Mm.
And his values are, like, it's more about pre-war... I think it's like the pre-war serenity of England. But I've thought that before with the Village Green, where I'm like, it is like, how do I wrestle my love for this record away from the fact that he's talking about an England that, like, I was never invited into.
It's very Brexity, his album, actually. Yeah, I was thinking Brexity, about it today. Yeah. It's like, even though it was, obviously, we weren't in the EU when he wrote it, I think he sort of caused Brexit in many ways because, I mean, because it was like... You know, he's harking back to this old, long-forgotten, nostalgic sort of version of Britain, which probably never really existed, you know. Now, I think...
How about this, though, for a hot take?
Go on.
Because I know that you two are going to have a lot more to say about this record than me, because...
You're just winding me up right now, like the Jack in the Box, and I'm going to start going any second here.
I was going to say, there's actually, if you think about the record itself, and there's actually, like, the only song about Britain on it, or like that style of England, is the song Village Green. The rest is just about people, isn't it? It's not really about, like, preservation.
It's about him going mad, isn't it, I think? And
I never really thought it was about that. I always thought that, personally, guys, but I'm not from England, that although it has a lot of that, like, his choice of words to tell the story, like, on the surface, it's, you know, about England and sort of this, like, pre-war, like, serene view of the country. But I always thought the Village Green was just more like a place in his own mind where he could retreat to and, like, get away from, like, crowds and, like, pressure to be a singer and to do... And it was almost like his sort of... Like, everybody's got their own Village Green, you know?
Yeah, I think you're right. And he seems very lost at the time, and he wasn't in touch with what was going on, like, in music. You know, he was going on his own path, and it was all very nostalgic and, you know, reminiscing about childhood. And he compares himself to a steam train, doesn't he, that's, like, going out of, you know, on its last journey.
That's classic autism, that, you know, obsession with trains.
Is it?
Yeah.
Are all train spotters autistic?
Yeah, well, I mean, if you think about it, it's kind of...
That had happened that same year, I read last night, too, that they decommissioned all the steam locomotives in England the year the record came out. And that's
yeah,
why.
So he was comparing himself. And it came out the same day as the White Album, I read.
Yeah, I was reading. That's unfortunate. Yeah. But you know what? It's like that's the last of the steam powered trains is like classic. I've talked about this before on the podcast about how Dave being, I mean, as a lyricist, maybe second to none, like that era, but great person to write in the second person. Like he and Randy Newman, I think, are the only guys who were really impressive to me at getting out of their own ego and kind of writing songs from the perspectives of other people and characters and even objects, you know? Mm. And I think it's pretty amazing because Beatles, you know, Beatles, all I, me, mine, you know, I've got a feeling, this, me, that, I am the cup. Walrus, blah, 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 love me. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, so you know, true. Dave's often, you know, Phenomenal Cat, Wicked Annabella, well, maybe that's Dave, but, you know, it's characters, it's a much more elevated level of lyricism to me. Like
Johnny Thunders.
The Beatles don't hold a candle to him as lyricists, in my opinion.
No. But,
different strokes for different folks, man.
Did you hear the story of when, I think when I've read it somewhere about them doing like a TV show with the Beatles or something, and John made some sort of cutting remark to Ray about them just being a sort of Beatles imposter group or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it broke his heart because he really loved the Beatles, you know. But
and Dave thought they sucked.
Did he?
I was reading last night. He said he thought they were shit and that Peter Quaife was always like praising them, and Dave was like, we can do this shit way better. And then he said that he used to, like, he ran into John Lennon all the time at this pub or something, like in the early 60s, and he thought John liked him because he just didn't give a fuck. What Dave said. He's like, I think he liked, and he said one night John and I were at the pub, and I'd had a few drinks and taken a bunch of pills, and so John couldn't stop me talking for about 2 hours. And then at the end, he just got up and walked away and said, you're the most obnoxious person I've ever met in my life. And Dave said, I took that as a great compliment.
Interesting.
Dave was quite a madhead, wasn't he, when he was young? There's a Kinks musical. I don't know if it's made it over to Canada. But, like, I fucking hate musicals. I've got, like,
I love them, but anyway.
Yeah, no, I just don't know why I hate them. But one day my mum was visiting and I was like, I'm going to take her to watch the Kinks musical because she loves the Kinks. And it was great because the music is amazing, obviously. But it was very like, it was their story, and Dave was just like a lunatic from day one. And Ray was just kicking the shit out of him all the time.
They're kind of bad boys. Like, comparatively, you know, if the Stone, nobody's as bad boy as the Stones, I guess. But the Kinks are definitely more bad boys than the Beatles, you know.
Yeah,
they're more London. They're more Cockney too.
Yeah, my dad told me that everyone thought the Beatles in the 60s. Everyone thought the Beatles were pussies because they were like just making like pop music, and until the late 60s when they started tripping out a bit, and then they're like, "Oh, you're actually quite cool." You know.
Well, the Kinks also didn't have an advance. They had a disadvantage from their band from playing in the United States for 4 years, and they made all their best records.
Do you think that stuff is like? I mean, obviously, like it gets kind of rubber stamped by Ray himself, who says, you know, like when we couldn't get to America because didn't Dave tell like the musicians union he was a communist or something? Like,
yeah, they
got in a fight with some guy who was like a kind
worked
of
at the consulate,
yeah. Yeah, and also they famously would fuck around with the crowd. My favorite story is when somebody refused to pay them up front, so they went out and played You Really Got Me for the whole concert. they played half an hour of
sounds like the greatest gig of all time.
Yeah,
sounds good. I ripped holes in my amp, the amp that you have of mine, Sam.
Oh, I sold it. Sorry.
Nice. That
yeah. Straight up your nose.
I'm just closing the window to stop the COVID coming.
Close
in.
Close the windy. Yeah.
It's so Spinal Tap, James. Like what he was saying about the musical. Like, I was just reading one thing. From its inception, Ray Davies considered the album for stage presentation.
Yeah.
And its general theme served to inspire the Kinks' more ambitious but less popular two-part theatrical work preservation in 72 to 74. Davies would refer to the three albums as his Preservation Trilogy, confirming that Preservation is directly related to Village Green Preservation Society.
Right. He's definitely voted Brexit.
Titanic's Requiem.
Yeah, exactly. It's totally that kind of like somebody up there likes me.
Yeah.
I wasn't saying that we were better or greater or comparing ourselves to Jesus Christ as a person or God as a thing or whatever it is. It was just I was saying it.
Hi, John.
And it was said, and now it was wrong, or it was taken wrong, and now it's all this.
I was
always trying to say something.
John, really how did you feel about the Kinks now that you've joined us on?
Well, it's not. I'm not quite at the point that I can say anything because I've just been working on the same things. He's always trying to teach you something a little bit, and then when he gets older, he's more. How can it be? You know, I'm just singing about my life, and you know, no, I can't do it. I'm saying I got up this morning and I had a good shit, and I love you, Yoko.
That was good. I love you, Yoko. Yeah, that was very good.
Yeah, he's kind of. Up here, isn't he? Yoko
he's
didn't
more
break
up here.
The Beatles.
The young
it was
guns.
Us. We were already there.
I wasn't saying we were great or comparing myself to Jesus Christ as a
Richard
person.
Richard Burton just came into the room in the middle of the accident.
George is more a little more back here. He's more critical of what he's more. He's a bit more criticized. You're always criticizing me.
It's a reverse. No,
nobody in Liverpool talks like the Beatles at all. Nobody ever has other than the Beatles. They've just got
very
their own
hard. I don't know
accent.
If you know this, Johnny. I don't know if you've been to Liverpool, but this is 100% true. There's most people there don't even speak English. They have their own language. It's called Scouse.
Really?
It's a completely different language, and it's very guttural, and it really just sounds like someone clearing their throat.
It's very high-pitched as well.
It's very high-pitched, isn't it? We won the fucking league!
Yeah. Spitting everywhere. Do you remember that video of Jamie Carragher spitting on a kid from his car?
Yeah, I mean, she was caught saying that he was a wanker or something.
Because United won. Anyway, it's fine, actually. Most of our patrons and listeners are English, so...
Really?
They'll get some. Yeah, thanks,
Sam. For some reason, yeah, thank you, Sam.
I guess we were thinking that English... What's your thoughts on it, Johnny?
I just think that English people are cooler. Like, everyone here is such a flake, man. Like, people in Canada and in the US, you know, they're kind of like, oh, yeah, cool, like, you got that podcast. Like, yeah, I listened to 5 minutes, sounded cool.
Yeah.
That's it, you know? Mm. But, like, I think people... They enjoy things there.
I've been really enjoying the podcast. I mean, it did start off like... two guys talking about an album, and now it's just become like an Eric Clapton true crime podcast.
Yes.
You know, which is good because, you know, you're unearthing the truth about the greatest serial killer of all time that, you know.
And I don't get me wrong, I don't mean to alienate our North American listeners, but, you know,
smooth.
Just call it like I see it, man.
Yeah.
Do you reckon Eric sort of bumped into the Kinks and, you know, I'm surprised he didn't turn up on the last of the steam power train. Because that's a blues, isn't it? It's like a sort of Howling Wolf blues.
Smokestack lightning kind of.
Yeah, smokestack halo.
What about Nicky Hopkins? Did you read about that? I thought that was very interesting. Check this out. With the exception of the early Village Green, like the track Village Green, strings and woodwinds were played on the Mellotron by Ray Davies and Nicky Hopkins.
On Phenomenal Cat, right?
On the whole record.
Yeah.
Hopkins contributed significant to the albums. He later stated that he provided about 70% of the work on the keyboards and developed a lifelong grudge when Davies apparently credited himself for the majority of the keyboard playing.
That was because he didn't want to pay him. Ray's notoriously a tight motherfucker.
Yeah. Is he? Yeah.
Yeah.
And grumpy, too.
Oh, he's so grumpy,
You see him around. I've seen him with you, Sam. Walking
there was
around.
That one time.
Holmesy, mate.
There was this one time, and me and James were in the pub in Crouch End, And I think my mum was there as well because she
were
was visiting.
Were we in the Haringey or what was it called?
We were in the Queen's. The King's Head.
Is that the one where you watched Tottenham beat United 5-0 or something?
No, that was a different one where I nearly got stabbed. But I was in the King's Head and we were sat in the window and we were talking about Ray Davies because I was like, I see him around all the time. And then as I said that, I was like, he's there. And he was walking past.
Yeah.
So fucking weird.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. And then
there's a lot of spots in Crouch End that are interesting. I mean, you can do a little tour. You can go to Conk. It used to really be like, well, it still is. It's just over the train tracks from Sam's house. But then from there, you can go to it's Banners as well. You can go to.
Yeah, that's where Dylan went and ate. Well, he didn't eat anything. He just drank a
margarita.
This
is all very important information to me, and I'm really excited for whenever we can get over there. I want the whole tour because you know all the. I want the Kink spots, the Dylan, the Nilsson, like that London vampires drinking haunts.
Oh, no worries, man. I'll take you on a tour.
We'll have a good one. Get on those Boris bikes.
Did I tell you the story of Dylan coming to Crouch End to meet Dave Stewart?
I wanted, you know what? My old friend Peter, rest in peace, he always used to say, he loves hearing good stories again because it's even more fun the second time because you kind of know. And I don't remember if you've told this on the pod, but I was hoping I could get you to tell the story. So
I don't know it. I don't think so.
So it's amazing.
So in the 80s at some point, Dylan had met Dave Stewart somewhere, and Dave Stewart had a recording studio in Crouch End that is now owned by,
infamous Crouch Enders, though.
Yeah, and Dave Stewart had said, listen, Bob, if you're ever in London, here's the address of the studio, just come along and jam, you know, and he's like, all right. So then Bob Dylan, there's a road in Crouch End that splits. There's one side's called Crouch End Hill, and the other side's called Crouch Hill, I think. It's very confusing. Anyway, Bob Dylan gets in a cab and says 15 Crouch End Hill, and the cab takes him to the wrong side, and there's just a house there. So he knocks on the door, confused, and goes "Is Dave here?" And this lady was like, "Yeah, come in." She's like, "He'll be home soon. In a minute, come in." So Bob Dylan goes and sits in the living room. This is supposedly happened. Sits in the living room waiting, and then this guy is a builder, comes home from work, called Dave. And he was she's like, Bob Dylan's in the living room waiting for you. And he's like, what? And then he went in and had a cup of tea with them. And then they were like, no, you're on the wrong fork. The studio's behind our house. So,
But he was a big Dylan fan too.
He was, yeah. And it's well documented, this story.
Yeah. Banners, the restaurant, which is sort of a Jamaican restaurant, really, I suppose, the sort of breakfast place. So yeah. And there's a plaque that says Bob Dylan once ate. What did he eat there again?
Well, at the time, you couldn't buy a drink in a restaurant without buying a meal on this particular day, some licensing law. So he just wanted a margarita and they wouldn't give him one. So he was like, you have to order a meal. So he ordered some spaghetti bolognese, but he didn't touch it.
Yeah.
I think it was that. They served loads of different food, but... Yeah, there's a little gold plaque on the wall. It says Bob Dylan sat here in 1988.
Yeah. 88, huh?
I think it was something like that.
Sounds like about the right era for that.
Yeah, it's kind of
Jamaican.
Wilbury's time.
Yeah, he'd probably have been over, doing Wilbury stuff.
Mm. Yeah.
He could have been at Dave Stewart's studio, actually.
Maybe, yeah.
Did he make a record with Dave Stewart? I mean,
I don't know.
Because Tom Petty did, you know?
Maybe he was visiting then. It's called The Church. David Gray bought it in the 90s.
The Church, that's not David Gray. Yeah. You know that...
Babylon.
You know Rebecca from my band's dad is called David Gray? And he sometimes he got David Gray's... Because he also is a musician. He once got David Gray's publishing accidentally sent to him for his Canadian publishing. I think they figured it out really quickly when he got a six-figure check sent to his house.
Bastard.
Pretty good.
Oh, my God.
I knew bought it. Do you know that producer, Paul Epworth?
Epworth has it.
He's bought it now, yeah.
Yeah. What he's doing with it's kind of interesting too, isn't it? Because it's like a mixed media. There's loads of different studios in it. I mean...
It's an amazing place. I've been in it a couple of times. Never recorded there, but just been in to have a nosy.
But he lives, he's from Muswell Hill, though.
Who?
The Davies brothers.
Yeah, their little cottage where they grew up is just up the road from here, and supposedly the pub opposite is the pub they played their first gig in, and the walls are just covered in Kinks memorabilia.
Yeah.
And they had a piano in the front room, and they used to have these like family sing-alongs around it, and that's where he wrote "You Really Got Me" on the piano.
Yeah, because he was wrestling with the sort of end of his career in 1968, doing Village Green, you know, at the and really sort of finding a path in life at the ripe old age of 23. It's mad to think how old they were when they put "You Really Got Me" out. Like Dave Davies would have been like 17.
Did you just tell me that he wrote "You Really Got Me" on the piano?
Yeah, he did. Cool. He like dun 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 dun. He wrote it as a kid in there, supposedly when he was like 16.
Well, you know that amp that you
the mugger stole off you.
That it was a really nice amp. It had the original speakers in it when I got it, and yeah. I ripped holes in them.
Because Dave Davies in.
Yeah, and then paper mache'd over the holes, and it was really cool for a bit. I mean, it was stupid of me to do it, but it did sound cool. That was in the
underrated guitarist, I always thought.
Not in my top five, mate.
He invented like the distorted guitar that sound, didn't he, really? Like sort of proto punk, you really got
definitely.
Me.
Definitely.
I always thought that they were the most punk of all the 60s groups. Well, I guess not of all, like them and the Velvets.
Punk, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Of, you know,
yeah, they, very, heavy they invented it, didn't
punk,
they?
Punk, for sure. Like, new wave, stabby stuff. Sabbath are the
I guess way, garage, right? Like, I yeah, guess Sonics. It's like garage. Sonics, yeah, for sure. I mean, Stooges is 60s, but like late, much
fucking
later.
Stooges,
you know.
Mate. No doubt.
Without a doubt.
Without a doubt, mate. Stooges, fucking mate.
Yeah.
Kinnell, mate. Do you guys Kinnell, know that? Mate. You don't have to say the F in that word, you know, if you're from Burnage. Kinnell, mate.
We used to do that at school. Me and my mates would be like, cough. And then you'd go, Kinnell. Mate. And cough, then the teacher mate. Would be like, what are you saying? Are you swearing? You'd be like, no. Yeah,
no.
So Kinnell.
It's like Jonah in Chris Lilly's Summer Heights. I was like, puck you, sir. Puck you, miss. It's like, I didn't say anything. I just said puck. Puck you.
Oh, yeah.
Puck you, miss.
But yeah,
speaking of that guitar. Do you know that Dave Davies' bio on his Instagram account says, Dave Davies, musician, band, the man behind the sound that changed rock and roll.
Nice.
He's not wrong.
No, but
yeah. Take it.
13,000 followers.
Yeah, on Insta.
He was tweeting about his love of big tits yesterday, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah. He loves
them. Who was that girl with the big tits at CBGB's? I loved her, and then he got loving, bollocked.
Yeah, sure we're loving big tits.
I love big tits.
Yeah, it's true. That's what he was saying yesterday.
Yeah, I like that.
No, I'm going to say he's not wrong.
No, there's not. She. It was her part of her show was getting her big tits out. That was the game. You know, it's good.
Sounds like a good game.
Yeah, I wish I had some big tits to get out.
Do you?
Just for some, do it for
if
a job.
If I continue drinking beer the way I am, I will soon. Different stuff.
We have another lockdown here. Yeah, you know, that's...
Are you guys in lockdown?
No. It's nothing like yours, mate.
We don't have a lockdown, no. Restrictions, but they're very... you know, this massive, album is almost too good to even talk about.
It's
that's
really
the problem
hard.
With this podcast.
I like, read the Rolling I can't, Stone. Yeah. I read the Rolling Stone original review of it. I don't know if you guys have read it. But it's actually amazing because it completely, it's written by Paul Williams in June 1969. I'll send it to you both. It completely nails why this record's so hard to talk about because he absolutely loves it. Like this guy is in love with the Kinks. He doesn't really even review the record. He just talks about how good they are. And he's just like talking about like every song Ray Davies writes is like a new friend I get to make. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, he keeps going. He's like, they're just the most wonderful band. Like the vocals are under recorded. So you have to turn the volume up and everything's just so sure and easy. No one's in a hurry. Just like, it's just a delight. And honestly, it's like paragraph on paragraph. He goes through it talking about, you know, nostalgia and what they like, it genuinely just like the real greatness of it. And he's writing this like in like 1969, and he's saying he's got a British copy of the record because you can't get it in the States. And he's just like, but I'm frustrated now. I was trying to make you feel, I was trying to make you understand how good the Kinks make me feel, but I can't pass on greatness. I can't sit here and come up with phrases to argue genius. I can only shout as modestly as possible about how deeply I'm affected. I'm thinking only genius could hit me so directly, destroy me and rebuild me so completely. And then he goes on, he's like, I've never had much luck turning people onto the Kinks. I can only hope you're onto them already. And if you are, brother, I love you. We've got to stick together.
Oh, cool. Wow, that's perfect.
It's a really great, it's a genuinely, it's a great review. And it's like completely, it's like it's prescient too, because he's like, this is who they're going to be. Mm-hmm. They're going to be these forgotten men.
The thing about it that is so special is it's funny that we did Pet Sounds and then we're doing this one, because to me, there it is, and it was sort of confirmed when I read something last night, that it kind of is a weird form of psychedelia to me. Like, it's kind of Ray's psychedelic rock album. And it's like, in the way that the Beach Boys and Disney version of psychedelia is like this reverting to childhood tendencies, it's a similar thing with this album. Like, it's not at all square to me. It's like his... It's just like him going to this place in his brain that's like he's a child again. And when I first heard this stuff in my, you know, I don't know how old I was when I first heard the record, it just already, as you grapple with this idea of nostalgia in your life and it being not a source of joy, memories not being a source of you know, fondness for your family or your life before, but a source of pain. Nobody had ever done that before, and it shook me so hard. Like, people take pictures of each other and then pictures of things as they used to be, don't show me no more, please. Like, it's terrible to look back at it, you know, like, and you the older you get and the more you listen to it, you're like, fuck, it's so true. And like, you, and you know, like how your mind shapes things to remember them differently, like in Do You Remember Walter and all that, you know, like it's just on and on, like almost hard to listen to. It's so good, you know.
Yeah, I revisited it recently, and like about a year ago, I got back into it, and I didn't listen to anything else other than that again for about a month. You know, it's just all I could listen to, and it's just so good. And I totally agree with you. Yeah, it's really sad, actually, the album.
It's so sad.
Yeah, he just has. I suppose he has the Kinks, like the Beach Boys, and there's other bands like, you know, even Led Zeppelin are a bit like this, but in a different, completely different place. But they totally have like a unique world view and like world system, and like every Kinks record sounds like a Kinks record. Like they're just like, and ABBA are like that. You know, just bands that are just like, well, ABBA just sound like ABBA. That's like what they sound like. The Kinks just sound like Kinks. Like, what about like the live Kinks? Like that record. It's like,
which one? The people what they want.
The live Kinks.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, it sounds like the audience is part of it in a way that most live records aren't. Like, it's weird. They just have their own little, they take up their own little space in the world. And the Beach Boys do that too, because Brian Wilson's just got his own little space that he, you know, like when you listen to him, it just, and no one else ever sounds like them.
But it's very sad music. Like, you're right. Like, and same with the Beach Boys. Like, there's something there. Whereas Led Zeppelin, you're totally right. Their own worldview, but it's like this more like kind of Valhalla. Like, we're pumped on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But
of course.
But Village Green, it's like a song. It's like one after another. Big Sky, Animal Farm, this Waterloo Isolation. Sunset.
He's very
sitting by
man,
the riverside,
you know.
Yeah, it's just like trying to get to this place in his own mind where he can block everything else out, you know. And that's a dark way to conceptualize an entire, you know, artwork like that, for sure.
You know,
but then it's like funky too and stuff. Like, so it's so cool.
I think part of the way in which the record was made as well, like he was just demoing stuff on an acoustic guitar or on piano, and then just basically sort of like thinking it might be a solo record, and then everyone kind of had apparently like free rein really just to like put on it whatever they wanted.
That what it is? I always wondered about his production. Like, he is the producer, but like, what did that mean? I'm sure it wasn't like a Brian Wilson level of like, he didn't arrange everything,
apparently like Pete Quaife. He, Quaife, mate. Quaife Turn.
Quaife.
quite. Come on, you goose. He apparently like. Well, he left the band, didn't he? Because, he wasn't getting on well with Ray and Dave. But you know, he says that this is the only collaborative record that they made. But you know. Why did he leave then?
You would want to put your name on the best one, wouldn't you?
Yeah, you would, yeah.
I'm just I'm not drinking at the moment, but I'm on these zero beers. I'm just going to get one from the fridge because they trick
Which brand are they, those ones?
Bavaria. They trick my brain into thinking I'm having a beer. They're great.
It's good that. I need to do that more often. I always see you doing it.
One sec, that'd be a good thing to do for these daytime pods, actually, because then you could still crack 0%. And then pump. You could still pump after.
Are you going to go pump after this? I'm thinking of going on a big run.
I ran last night. Rain run. It was good. Yeah. Listen to Village Green. I'm not gonna lie to you. Cried.
Mm. Yeah.
Something about running in the rain and you're like really exhausting yourself. And when you put on music you haven't listened to in a long time, like I was at about 6K and kind of my body was drained and just some part in Big Sky came on or something and you just kind of you just started just fucking.
Oh man.
Blubbering,
you know? Days was going to be on it.
Was it?
Yeah. What a tune that is, hey?
What a tune to leave off.
It was a single, though. It was a single.
Yeah, but they left it off the record. It was recorded for the record.
But that's kind of like a 60s thing, isn't it? Like the Beatles never had any singles.
I don't think it's specifically for that reason. Like, that's true. Alan Klein, Shredder, is the one who, like, changed that, didn't he? By, like, putting singles on records for the Beatles, but... No, apparently it was their decision to leave it off. It was like a deliberate one.
It was a bit of a hit though, Ray. I think.
I saw an interview with Ray ages ago, and he was saying after the early career with the hits, he's like, when he talks sort of a bit low like that, doesn't he? He's like, you know, when we released You Really Got Me, it was like an avalanche, you know, they just wanted all the hits from me and I just wanted to retreat, you know, and I didn't want to go to Carnaby Street. I wanted to stay at home, you know, and that...
I think that, though, that's the thing about Days is, like, it really... You kind of nailed it, Johnny, because, like, yeah, here's a quote about it where it's like, from Dave, he says, my feelings at the time were always very mixed about Days because I always thought it was a very, very unhappy song. It was sad and it didn't have Ray's humor in it. And it saddens me every time I hear it, in fact. And Pete was unhappy at the time and Ray was going through a lot of trauma in his personal life.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ray says, it's a goodbye song, but it's also an inspirational song. It could also mean a new beginning. But I wanted to write a sad song with optimism in it, which is how I've always thought of it. But like my sister Rosie had gone to Australia and we didn't have any communication. So she left and said goodbye. And I said, thank you for being my sister. The song's for her, really, and her generation. So, you know, it's a bit sad. So they left it off themselves. You know, it was their decision.
Yeah, but
it was like an early version. It was going to be on side one.
Yeah, I don't know if it would work on the album because it's too much of a hit. Like, there's no big hits on there because it's
Waterloo Sunset, though, I guess.
Well, there's no big hits on.
There's no hits
on Village Green, is there? You know?
Yeah, there's no hits. No singles, like no clear cut single.
Like picture
that's
book,
what's good
right,
about
or
it.
Some
picture
book,
the closest one. But yeah,
man, I was looking up Picture Book last night, and there was a heated conversation going on about how many songs have ripped it off.
Really?
On YouTube, like Green Day, Warning, most famously,
100%, yeah.
Mac DeMarco, Salad Days.
No, Mac DeMarco's one's brutal. That's like just a full on.
He does that all the time.
I remember Sam telling you actually calling me about that one and being like, "Have you heard this?"
Yeah.
Stone Temple Pilots, Big Bang Baby.
Oh sure.
Stereogram.
Sooner then as well. I guess it's kind of
Stereogram. Yeah. Walkie Talkie Men.
Well, let's go through a couple of these here.
Put
some on.
So I mean. Big Bang Baby makes sense, like the
yeah. Just in the vibe, you know.
Yeah, yeah, I think so.
You know,
here we go. Let's go quickly here. It's coming up though, Johnny.
That's it. I got it.
No,
you can't do that.
Scooby-dooby-doo.
No, actually, I mean, I'm fine with him doing that. I think it's really cool. But, yeah.
Do you know that Scooby-Doo hadn't come out yet?
What?
Wow.
When Ray said that? Yeah, it came out a year later.
He invented Scooby-Doo.
He said Scooby-Dooby-Doo, and then that was the slogan for the show a year later.
What?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Ever since Buff Carell danced to Scooby-Doo, I've had it in my head.
Scooby-Dooby-Doo, where are you? You got some work for you now.
Great song.
Come on, Scooby-Doo.
Yeah. That's really cool. It's kind of him doing a bit of like jazz improvisation, isn't it, really?
Scatting. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just...
he does some scatting on that record.
He kind of scats, yeah.
I love all the, like, oh, they're great with that. I don't even know what you call that. I guess it's sort of like, a, you know, la ba ba da ba ba bum. Like, yeah. He does all kinds of, like, melodies and singing that aren't words on that record.
He's
great.
He's kind of singing the imagined horn parts, isn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally. Yeah. It's really cool.
But it works like better. Like, it sounds cooler. It's like a Beach Boys kind of feel,
kind of
I guess.
Beach Boys-y feel. Like, yeah, but without
girl
the
group. Girl
without
group.
Without the talent, I guess. You know what I mean? Without the ability to do the harmonies and stuff, it's just like this is what I hear, and you know, yeah. Harpsichords.
Like if the Kinks had done "Got to Get You Into My Life," Ray would have just gone ba ba da ba ba da 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 da. Have you ever read his review of Revolver?
No.
2-word review for this one.
What? You guys haven't read that? Oh my God, I'll send it to you. It's the best thing. In 66, Ray reviewed Revolver for a magazine.
No way.
And said, track by track, it's really good. Just a couple sentences on each song. And he said, you know, like, it's amazing because it would be exactly what we would think. He says Yellow Submarine's like a complete load of rubbish. And like his top three songs are I'm Only Sleeping.
Yeah.
Good Day Sunshine and Here, There, and Everywhere.
Oh, yeah, you know.
No, and Your Bird Can Sing.
You know, he hated Andrew Berg Can Sing. He said, really? This is not, it doesn't even sound like a Beatles song. He says, this sucks.
That's the best
pretty
one.
Beatles-y. It's pretty Beatles-y, that one, I think.
And he said that he thought Tomorrow Never Knows would be big in the club, in the discos.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And
kind of like Proto Chemical Brothers, in it? So he was right, I guess.
And he said that Got to Get You Into My Life with the jazz backing was a prime example of how English jazz musicians can't swing.
Well.
Oh, trad jazz, right? He's talking about, I guess, the trad jazz scene.
Going back to England, the ripping off of Kink songs, the first time I met Ray, I was recording at Conk Studios before I lived down here. I still lived in Manchester and came down to record there and didn't expect to see him really, but I'd fallen asleep and I was in a band with one of mine, James's friends, Joe, and we were recording this song I'd written. And I didn't thought about it at the time. Anyway, I fell asleep on the sofa while someone was doing their parts. And Joe woke me up and he's like, do you want to meet one of your heroes? And I opened my eyes and Ray was just stood there. And I was like, fuck. I was like, all right, mate. And he's like, hello. You know, and just sort of, how you doing? You having a nice time here and stuff? And I was like, yeah, yeah. And I was just sort of gobsmacked. But then realized as we were recording that the song we were recording while he walked in had totally ripped off him. And it was like, it was just a copy of like, So Tired of Waiting. And then on ours, it was like, I've been on down, 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 down.
I remember that song.
Yeah, and I'd like just totally ripped him off accidentally. And he just walked in and he was like, yeah, nice song like that. And I could see he just worked it out straight away. I was like,
yeah.
We both realized
it. Oh my God. How mortifying.
You know, it was, but also really funny.
Yeah,
I think
of course.
There's another time in which you peeped over the fence when you actually lived, because you used to live in a very truly English way, even closer to Conk. You live about 5 houses away from it now, but you used to live right next to it.
Next door. This was one of the best days in my life, right? And
yeah.
I was out in my back garden backed onto the garden of Conk, and I was living in this little bedsit place in a basement flat, and I went out into the garden to like hang some washing out, and I could hear like sunny afternoon on an acoustic guitar, and I was like, the fuck? And I realized just over the wall, like a meter away, Ray was playing acoustic guitar in the garden running some Kink songs. And I was like,
why?
Because, well, I realized afterwards he had a show in Hyde Park later that week, so he was probably just running the old tunes in the garden in the sun. And so I lay like back against the wall. He didn't know I was there. I just lay my back against the wall. And I was like crying. I had basically a private Ray Davis show for about 15 minutes. And he,
oh my god, that's amazing, Sam.
It was unbelievable, honestly. Yeah. But yeah, he didn't know.
Was he doing a Deadbeat song without knowing it?
Yeah, he was. Yeah, it was.
Have you ever tried to play some of those songs on the guitar?
No.
Like, it's fucking crazy how hard they are. Like, with Village Green, like, do you remember Walter has like 16 chords in it or something?
Wow.
They're really complicated songs. And Days, really cool chords as well.
Mm.
And I was reading about that apparently he listened to a lot of like Chet Atkins when he was a teenager, and they didn't know, so they learned all these crazy chord inversions. That shit's so cool. And then they just like would play all the time. So they,
it's
but
a
yeah,
lot different to when the Beatles had to get a bus down Penny Lane to learn how to play a B chord.
You know, we knew the E, we knew the E and the A, and we needed to go and get the B7.
I can't do it though.
The B7.
I can't do it. I'm intimidated when I'm with English guys.
I'm in London now, so it's fucking hard for me to do anything other than
we're down here now.
You know, the funny thing is, with Maswell Hill, there isn't actually a Village Green there.
No, I think there used to be one in Fortis Green, which is just outside of Maswell Hill where they grew up. But I think they like built a pub on it or something.
Yeah, there wasn't, and they never had a Village Green, so the landscape of the mind theory does make sense, you know.
Very interesting. Another day, cool thing that happened from living next door to Conk. They had, what do you call it? Do you call it a skip in Canada? You know, like
it's so hard when you've lived here this long. There's words that I have to really search for the English versions of them, and sometimes search for the Canadian ones.
Describe it to me.
It's a thing that goes outside a house that you put trash
like
in.
Like a big metal thing.
It's massive.
Like if you're doing like a clear out of a building.
Dumpster?
Yeah, no, but it's bigger than a dumpster. It's like the ones that go outside, like when they're like throwing out loads of stuff from a house.
And you
They just call it like a bin or something.
Like one of those construction bins.
We call them a skip. And anyway, there was one outside.
I found a dog in a skip once.
You did?
Yeah, I found a dog in a skip when I was a kid and called it Skip.
Oh, nice.
Kept him.
That's great.
It's a great dog too.
Well, anyway, I was walking past, there was a skip outside of Conk, and I was walking past there. And I was like, they're going to be throwing out some good shit. So I started having a root around in there. And I found like the front fascia of like a Marshall amp. And then on the grill was sprayed the Kinks with their logo. Right. So it was like the front piece of a Kinks amp. Right. And I was like, oh, my God. So I like smuggled it into my house. And I was like, yes. You know, it was like my prized possession. And my brother was going through some bad shit at the time. And he's a massive Kinks fan. So I gave it to him as like a gift, and he was like, overjoyed. And then his fucking ex-wife threw it away. I was like, "Where's that Kinks amp?"
Love you, women.
And she's. If you're listening, Natalie, go fuck yourself. It got thrown away. But yeah, I found like the front of a Kinks amp. It's just unbelievable.
Why did they spray paint the Kinks on the front?
I don't know.
Like touring, mate.
Really?
Touring,
I guess.
You know, it's just what they do in it on the road, you know what I mean?
On amps? I've never really seen that.
On the grill, you know?
Yeah, I've seen it before. But it was a bit weird, but I was like, that's brilliant. I'm having that.
Maybe it isn't a thing that people do. Maybe someone can message us and, you know, people who have more experience of, like, roadieing, because we're kind of more artists, and let us know if that's a normal thing to do.
When
spray
I was
painting the band name on the grill.
Very odd.
When I was a teenager, I was as a drummer, like I played in kind of a skiffle group in my teens.
In the 50s.
We wore
just
black
before,
suits.
Yeah, you kind of doing it in order. Like yeah, skiffle it into was. The
we did
early
like
Beatles into
yeah,
kind of
we did like black suits and like played like, you know, that kind of stuff.
Played the washboard.
Yeah. And
where's
and
the
I
washboard,
played,
that kind of stuff.
Well, yeah, you know, it was kind of a...
When I'm cleaning windows, if you could see what I could see.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff.
Exactly, yeah.
Just some George Formby.
Something tells me I'm into something good. We did that
there
one.
There you go, that's good, yeah.
Jerry
from Jerry and the Pacemakers.
Woke up this morning feeling fine.
Okay.
Barbershop,
bit barbershop, that one.
Yeah, same key, I think.
Too much perspective.
And I thought I saw like an old R&B group like from the 60s and the drummer just had his name painted on the drum skin instead of the name of the group.
That's
like
cool.
So I did that, and sort I still have the skin Johnny Payne. I was just the drummer. The band was called something else, but
yeah, bit of a union move. It's like how Elvis Costello always used to have his union, union ticket in his pocket of his suit.
Really,
he'd have it. His musician's union card.
That's funny you say that too, because his guitar says Elvis Costello on the fingerboard.
There's a left-handed Mustang on Craigslist right now. Should I buy it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, he played a Jazzmaster, but should I buy it? Because you don't come along very often being left-handed. I don't really want it.
Well, that's the thing, right? It's like how Clapton bought Jimi Hendrix that left-handed Stratocaster the night he died.
Mm. Interesting.
He knew he could take it straight back after he killed him.
Did you see that?
He's covering his tracks, they call that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Clapton tried to sell his guitar the other day on the internet. Yeah. Johnny, you know a bit
I
more
saw
about
that he... Clapton put his famous Stratocaster Blackie up for auction, and the starting bid was £1 million and didn't get one bid.
No, who wants that?
They're all selling still.
Wait, why?
Yeah,
you know, well, it's a bit early for me to do it, but you
maybe
know,
they're all going to board a spaceship and like head to Valhalla or something.
Many times
I recorded in the early days of the band. I engineered everything myself, and
I saw that Robbie Robertson selling his console on the internet right now, his Neve console, and it said, funny if you read through, all these guys are so fucking delusional. You read through like what he thinks has been recorded on his Neve console, and then just like all you need to do is like cross check it with like whether it really was. Like he says that like the casino soundtrack he did on it, and you look at the casino soundtrack and it's just like he's not mentioned at any point at all on the casino soundtrack. He's just like, well, Martin will just, he won't sue me if I say I did it, and I might get an extra couple of grand or something. Like,
and he said about the board, he said, you know, when I bought the board, I said darling, I'm gonna take you on an amazing journey. And I did. And it was the beginning of the beginning of the end of the beginning of the end of the beginning.
Fucking guy, man.
He's weird, Robbie
Robertson.
I wonder
if he got Scorsese to help him with it, the writing, the advert. Yeah.
I'm going to take you on quite an adventure. Yeah. And I did.
I actually saw Robbie Robertson in a documentary. I did some recording in Toronto a couple of years ago in Chickasaw, which is this, it's on the Six Nations. It's an indigenous like reserve, a massive one. And there's a movie, a documentary about it. And Robbie's from there, Robbie Robertson, or at least, you know, he has indigenous heritage. Mm. Mm-hmm. So he was in this documentary. It's really actually really good. It's a really good documentary. I should tell you what it's called right now.
Put in the show notes.
It's really worth watching because he talks a lot about show notes. So we always say it's going to be them and I forget. But he, he's like talking about going down to like Yonge Street and playing there. And like there's some great stuff about like him being told early on by other indigenous. They were all sort of hiding the fact that they were, you know, obviously it's like a massively marginalized community in Canada still, and can't imagine what it was like in the 60s, but like people saying like, this is your secret power, like it's your secret weapon, Robbie, like don't think of it as a curse, like we're better at music, you know, because we've got this other stuff that we can like lean into. It's really cool.
All right, send us that.
In this, let me look it up. It's
where do you rank the Kinks, Sam?
In best bands ever?
All time, yeah.
Top five, I think. Yeah, they're one of my favorite bands ever, I think. I'm more of a song guy. I really like songs rather than anything else. And he's up there with the Beatles for me, you know. And
yeah, they're top two for me, I think.
And it's him and Brian Wilson and, you know, Lennon. They're the top three songwriters for me.
I used to always say Beatles, Kinks were top two, and then I always had trouble between the Velvet Underground and the Beach Boys at three. I would always go back and forth, and you know, I don't do as much ranking now as I did then. But
yeah, it's important to rank things.
It is, I think.
Definitely on a podcast.
Well, yeah, I mean, make a lot of grandiose rank. Like, you know, sometimes when you're sitting around messed up listening to records, I'll probably say on a night like that over the course of the night 10 or 20 times, this is probably the greatest song ever written.
Yeah.
You know? Well, it's just fun to say it.
Yeah, what is the greatest song ever written?
I think the other night I said it was like Conway Twitty. It's only make-believe or something like that.
Change is gonna come, maybe?
Yeah.
Ever written?
Yeah. No, in terms of like important things.
Oh, we'll see. Yeah, I don't know.
Important and like good at the same time, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a good one for sure.
Important.
I was like My Girl.
Yeah. My Girl?
That's a I don't good know. One. Just,
Pretty
just,
Woman? That's
perfect
cool.
or something.
I think God Only Pretty Knows Woman. Is the best song ever written.
Yeah. Pretty Ballerina is pretty good.
Mm. There's some good.
I heard that the other day. I really liked it.
Yeah. It's kind of like a cool, like, perfect pop song. Baroque pop, you know?
I mean, man, there's so many. Like a Rolling Stone's pretty good.
Mm. I've heard of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but like, I think for me, it's like probably like a standard. Like, I think like Stardust by Hoagie Carmichael is like an amazingly perfect song for like the 20s, you know, like the lyrics and music are just, and a lot of those, yeah, you know, like As Time Goes By or something. I don't know. It depends on my mood.
Yeah, what about like You've Lost That Loving Feeling?
Oh, yeah, true.
It's pretty good.
It's very moving.
It's a good one. Yeah. Yeah. Really struggling to find the name of this documentary, so I'm just gonna. I actually will put this in the show notes.
I don't believe
really
you. Have you done any show notes yet?
No,
but we always say we do, and that's
same thing, really.
You know, part of it.
Yeah, and I've got like this new lead that like that I can play like any song, like
put a song on
quickly. Like for example, I could play this.
Crazy River?
Yeah.
Nice.
It's kind of some Robbie, you know?
Yeah, I can see it now.
The distant red neon. I thought that was you.
Yeah. I was feeling like a stranger in a strange land. Sam, was this song ever famous in England?
You are. You know where people play games with the night. Can't hear you.
Was this song famous in England?
No, but I've heard it.
Crazy River, do you know it?
I don't know it very well, but I've heard
Big
it.
Big chorus.
Very sexual.
We'll do the chorus. All of a sudden I could hear somebody whistling right behind me. I turned around and she said,
"Why do you always end up down at Nick's Cafe?" Is he doing Tom Waits?
Yeah, I think so. I don't know. The wind just kind of pushed me this way. It's a really weird one.
I assume he's not singing the chorus.
He can't
right?
get up there.
I think that's him.
He can't get up there.
I think it's him.
I don't think that's him singing the chorus. Like he got like Paul Butterfield in or something.
You think so?
I don't know who it is. I don't think it's him.
Yeah, because I don't think he can get up there. He's got really deep.
No.
It kind of sounds a little bit like Danko.
Oh, yeah, but I think he's dead already.
Yeah, but it sounds like him. It's weird, actually. Maybe it's Robbie. Listen.
No way.
Might be.
Maybe.
It kind of sounds like Danko. And it's also, he often did the high harmonies, or at least it looked like he was doing them.
No, he just had a mic. He just had a mic set up on stage.
Yeah, it was turned down, I think.
Okay. There was no cord, no XLR plugged into it.
That's a beautiful song, though. Yeah, I'm going to get that on.
You like that one?
Yeah. It sounds like he's just doing Tom Waits in the verses, kind of, or Leonard Cohen.
He's a strange man, isn't
he? Yeah, he's kind of doing a Leonard Cohen. I wonder what's going on.
Partial lineage.
For sure, yeah. Canadians.
Yeah.
You know? It's a shame when Leonard Cohen had to like come out of retirement when he was just a monk for ages because he found out his manager had been nicking all of his money.
Yeah, but it was. But I got to see him live, so I don't care.
True. Yeah.
Who, Leonard?
Yeah, I saw him at Glastonbury.
Yeah, that was probably the best show I've ever seen.
Oh, he was
amazing. Here in Vancouver. I got, my friend got tickets, fifth row center,
whoa.
And Jeff Bridges was sitting in front of me. And he was like on his feet, just loving the show the whole time. We were all like, oh my God, it was so amazing, the concert.
Did you throw him a mixtape like when you saw Zooey Deschanel? when we went to Zooey Deschanel, I said hello to him.
I said, great show. Hey, dude.
You said and hello he to like, Zooey Deschanel too, but you got thrown out by security. You got
her security
out.
Swarmed me when I tried to tell give her a letter I'd written her. Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard this story before. But
Well, there's still hope, you know.
Maybe she listens to the podcast.
I know. Maybe, well, that's kind of why I started it.
Yeah.
Because, like, I'm just long game. I'm trying to do as much different, like, make records, do podcasts, like, as much stuff that could potentially reach her, you know?
Does she still make, like, twee ukulele music? You should do a record of that.
You know, one time I saw her play and she said, guys, everyone needs to be really quiet now, because obviously everyone was like screaming. Because if it's kind of like a Stephen Stills move. It's like, if you don't shut up, like, you won't get it. You know, you won't get what we're about. You won't get the wisdom we're about to drop. You know, I think he says that on Four Way Street. He's like, you know, you guys are gonna have to be real quiet, otherwise you won't get it.
No, he says. He starts playing like a blues song, Black Queen, and then he talking about how he's like the same as being an old black man like on a porch singing
the blues,
and people in the audience start laughing, and then he gets really mad because he's all coked up, and he stops and he says, "If there's one thing the blues ain't, it's funny."
You know,
but he doesn't get why they're laughing at him, because he thinks he's like,
and he's going, like, wow.
Oh, you gonna bet on the Black Queen?
It's also like that video of him when he starts a fight at Monterey.
Big Sur, yeah.
Big Sur, when he starts a fight, and then he with a guy in the crowd, and then he goes back on stage and says he was lucky enough that you know, his friends were able to love him out of his anger. We're up here with our fur coats on.
We're up here with our fur coats, and you know, sometimes we just forget what's important.
I wonder what he's up to.
And because the guy in the crowd was upset that he had to pay like $20 to see fucking Stephen Stills play. So and you know, he's probably messed up or something. And then Stephen Stills decided the way to respond to that was to charge him in the crowd, try to beat him up.
Wow.
While wearing a fur coat. And then he plays 4 and 20.
Yeah.
As though that'll kind of make it all better.
Yeah. So when I saw Zooey Deschanel, she was kind of in a similar place in her musical, you know, career. And she was telling a crowd of swooning and, you know, fawning fans of her TV show, I think, including Johnny, who'd wet his pants and he'd already thrown a mixtape at her. But she said, everyone needs to be quiet here. I'm playing a ukulele and you guys won't get it if you don't, like. And then she did a cover of Wouldn't It Be Nice.
Oh. Wow. Yeah, and then I got up and told everybody to shut the fuck up.
Yeah,
shut up.
She's trying to play something.
She's trying to play a song, a beautiful song.
Trying to, like, impress
you
her.
You guys,
like,
don't deserve this.
Man.
I like the Beach Boys too, I yelled out.
Yeah.
Oh,
man.
I'm only making fun of Johnny because I had a rival mixtape that I'd thrown.
And I
still don't know what was on yours.
Well, you know, it was like... a lot of
you
sort
doing
of
covers.
It was me doing a lot of like unrequited love, you know, sort of Boots of Spanish Leather.
Certainly, it's a good one.
Yeah, kind of Simon and Garfunkel, Kathy's song, you know.
And just voice recordings.
And then in between, kind of messages.
Yeah.
Spoken word. Sonnet. I would read sonnets.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Kind of. Chaucer, even, maybe, going back that far. Kind of whimsy.
Wordsworth, yeah.
More okay, yeah, Wordsworth. Well, that's good. I mean...
Mm-hmm. Is the restraining order still in place, or are you allowed to our shows now?
No, the restraining order is still in place.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, luckily for me, there are no shows, because if she were touring through town, it would be pretty hard to keep out of the venue.
It's kind of a Clute-style scenario.
Yeah.
Really, it's kind of like a Jane Fonda in Clute thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there you go. I mean, it's really nice to catch up with you, Sam.
Yeah, it's been great. Thanks for having me again.
A little quote here. I just reading, actually. This is good. Talking about, it's a quote from Ray, where he says, when the Rolling Stones do a comeback, they use Yankee Stadium. And when the Kinks make one, we'll probably do it in a bar on the east side.
Wow. That's great. Hey, that's Sam, nice. I want to thank you for that story about you hearing Ray and laying against the fence. That was a beautiful thing to hear. It reminded me of, you know, one of those happy stories like the one I told about Harry Nilsson meeting the Beatles. Mm-hmm. And then the next day, it was really sweet. You sent us a voice message saying you were walking by Harry's apartment.
Yeah.
And you kind of like kissed the sky, gave a toast to our fallen our fallen brothers and sisters, and I appreciated that.
Yeah, man. Well, that was the flat that Eric murdered two people in, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah,
Mama Cass.
We're trying to get like positive this year. You know, we know that we're going to be doing a lot of kind of Laurel Canyon kind of feel good stuff, and which eventually will lead us to having to do the Eagles, and it'll get dark again, but that'll be in about 2 months. But until then, we're going to stay positive, so probably going to leave the Clapton murders unsolved for a couple of months.
Leave it. It was best left unsolved.
Best left unsolved.
Eric will be very happy about that.
All right, boys.
All right. Thanks a lot, guys. Thanks for having me. I'm a very big fan of the podcast.
See you again soon, Sam.
Yeah, take care.
See you, matey. Bye-bye.